In a much-quoted passage in his inaugural address, President Kennedy said, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." It is a striking sign of the temper of our times that the controversy about this passage centered on its origin and not on its content. Neither half of the statement expresses a relation between the citizen and his government that is worthy of the ideals of free men in a free society. The paternalistic "what your country can do for you" implies that government is the patron, the citizen the ward of you that is at odds with the free man's belief in his own responsibility for his own destiny. The organismic "what you can do for your country" implies that government is the master or the deity, the citizen, the servant or the votary. To the free man, the country is the collection of individuals who compose it, not something over and above them. He is proud of a common heritage and loyal to common traditions, but he regards government as a means, an instrumentality, neither a grantor of favors and gifts, nor a master or god to be blindly worshipped and served. He recognizes no national goal except as it is the consensus of the goals that the citizens severally serve. He recognizes no national purpose except as it is the consensus of the purposes for which the citizens severally strive. The free man will ask neither what his country can do for him, nor what he can do for his country. He will ask rather, what can I and my compatriots do through government to help us discharge our individual responsibilities, to achieve our several goals and purposes, and above all, to protect our freedom? And he will accompany this question with another, how can we keep the government we create from becoming a Frankenstein that will destroy the very freedom we establish it to protect? Freedom is a rare and delicate plant. Our minds tell us, and history confirms, that the great threat to freedom is the concentration of power. Government is necessary to preserve our freedom and is an instrument through which we can exercise our freedom. Yet, by concentrating power in political hands, it is also a threat to freedom. Even though the men who wield this power initially be of good will, and even though they be not corrupted by the power they exercise, the power will both attract and form men of a different stamp. How can we benefit from the promise of government while avoiding the threat to freedom? Two broad principles embodied in our Constitution give an answer that has preserved our freedom so far, though they have been violated repeatedly in practice while proclaimed as precept. First, the scope of government must be limited. Its major function must be to protect our freedom both from the enemies outside our gates and from our fellow citizens, to preserve law and order, to enforce private contracts, to foster competitive markets. Beyond this major function, government may enable us at times to accomplish jointly what we would find it more difficult or expensive to accomplish severally. However, any such use of government is fraught with danger. We should not and cannot avoid using government in this way. But there should be a clear and large balance of advantages before we do. By relying primarily on voluntary cooperation and private enterprise in both economic and other activities, we can ensure that the private sector is a check on the powers of the governmental sector and an effective protection of freedom of speech, of religion, and of thought. The second broad principle is that government power must be dispersed. If government is to exercise power, better in the county than in the state, better in the state than in Washington. If I do not like what my local community does, be it in sewage disposal or zoning or schools, I can move to another local community, and though few may take this step, the mere possibility acts as a check. If I do not like what my state does, I can move to another. If I do not like what Washington imposes, I have few alternatives in this world of jealous nations. The very difficulty of avoiding the enactments of the federal government is, of course, the great attraction of centralization to many of its proponents. It will enable them more effectively, they believe, to legislate programs that, as they see it, are in the interest of the public, whether it be the transfer of income from the rich to the poor, or from private to governmental purposes. They are in a sense right. But this coin has two sides. The power to do good is also the power to do harm. Those who control the power today may not tomorrow. And more important, what one man regards as good, another may regard as harm. The great tragedy of the drive to centralization, as of the drive to extend the scope of government in general, is that it is mostly led by men of goodwill, who will be the first to reap its consequences. The preservation of freedom is the protective reason for limiting and decentralizing governmental power. But there is also a constructive reason. The great advances of civilization, whether in architecture or painting, in science or literature, in industry or agriculture, have never come from centralized government. Columbus did not set out to seek a new road to China in response to a majority directive of a parliament, though he was partly financed by an absolute monarch. Newton and Leibniz, Einstein and Bohr, Shakespeare, Milton, and Pasternak, Whitney, McCormick, Edison, and Ford, Jane and Adams, Florence Nightingale, and Olbert Schweitzer. No one of these opened new frontiers in human knowledge and understanding, in literature and technical possibilities, or in the relief of human misery in response to governmental directives. Their achievements were the product of individual genius, of strongly held minority views, of a social climate permitting variety and diversity. Government can never duplicate the variety and diversity of individual action. At any moment in time, by imposing uniform standards in housing or nutrition or clothing, government could undoubtedly improve the level of living of many individuals. By imposing uniform standards in schooling, road construction, or sanitation, central government could undoubtedly improve the level of performance in many local areas and perhaps even on the average of all communities. But in the process, government would replace progress by stagnation. It would substitute uniform mediocrity for the variety essential for that experimentation which can bring tomorrow's laggards above today's mean.